Good afternoon. Seeing the time and that we have a quorum, I call to order the meeting of the Policy Review Committee. This is February 26, 2019. First, I would like to welcome new board members to our first Policy Review Committee meeting that we're holding together. We had a slight inclement weather delay a couple weeks ago, so I'd like to introduce, starting down here, Ms. Lily Rowe, representative of District 6. And we have Mr. John Offerman, who is the Vice Chair of Policy Review Committee, and he is an at-large member of the board. And we have Ms. Cheryl Pasture, representing District 2. And Ms. Halima Adekoya, our student member of the board, and Ms. Margaret Ann Howey, our staff liaison. So the first item on the agenda is the minutes and the live video footage of the November 12th, 2018 meeting represents the minutes of the meeting. So the minutes stand approved as recorded. The second item of business is unfinished business, and I would like to welcome representatives from TABCO, CASE, ESPBC, and AFSCME. Tonight we have Ms. Maureen Astorita representing CASE, and she'll be coming up in a moment to speak with us. She's a member of the CASE Executive Board and principal of Parkville High School. We have with her Mr. Tom DeHart, the Executive Director of CASE, and we have with us tonight Jeanette Young, our president of our ESPBC, and we have Celeste Odewall, also from ESPBC, a Uniserve representative. Thank you for joining us. And we have Ms. Abby Baton from TABCO, its president. And we also have with us tonight Glenn Galante from TABCO, the executive director. And we have with us Michael Fahey, who is representing AFSCME as its president. So what we wanted to do as we're discussing our discipline policies is to bring forward our bargaining units, as you all represent a key group of our stakeholders who are doing the work of education, who are with students, and representing groups that work to support our students. So we wanted to hear from you all first. So with that, I wanted to bring forward Ms. Maureen Astorita to share with us concerns and ideas and suggestions from your stakeholders.
Does it matter where I sit? Which one of these?
That's fine. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. This is my first time I've had an opportunity to come and speak before any members of the board, so thank you. I appreciate that very much. As a principal of Parkville High School, but also just to share with you my history, grew up in Baltimore County, so I graduated from a Baltimore County high school, became a teacher, became an assistant principal, and now a principal. When I look into the board policy and look at, you know, the policies and the rules, they were revised a few years ago, and I think that they were revised in a way that was meaningful to administrators because it made us step back and it made us dig in deeper and really look at what progressive discipline was. It stopped us from immediate suspension, and it gave us recommendations for things that we could do prior to removing a student from a classroom. The way that it is written absolutely serves the vast majority of our students. But what we're running into is that we have a growing population of students that the needs are severe. We're talking about violent behaviors, drugs, weapons, that the solution right now are Band-Aids. They're temporary. We remove a student from a building for a period of time, and then they sometimes thrive outside of the comprehensive building, but then are returned back to the environment that they were previously in to simply repeat the behaviors. So when I look at the policy and the rules the way it is written, again, I think that it meets the needs of most of our students, but we have to come up with solutions to meet the needs, especially at the secondary level, for those students who have fallen into a pattern and that it becomes repetitive. And we can, we have some students that by the time they get to the high school level have been to an alternative program multiple times, and nothing that we have to offer them is changing the behaviors. So it goes beyond what is written, and it really requires us to come up with some other solutions to meet the needs of this very kind of special group of students who need more than we're currently offering them. That can come with staffing. It can come with additional alternative programs that aren't just temporary solutions. That's all I have to say at this time.
Well, thank you for sharing. Do board members have questions?
Yes, ma'am.
Ms. Adekoya?
Mm-hmm. Do you have any idea of any solutions, like solutions that you think can be put into place?
So from the perspective of the high school principal, many of the students who are removed from our building for a period of time, and first of all, let's mention the fact that I am one of the two largest high schools within the county. So oftentimes our students, when they exit our building, thrive in a smaller setting with additional resources. So like Rosedale Alternative Center would be one of those examples that I'm speaking of. But then that's only for a quarter or two, and then they're brought right back into our building. And oftentimes some of those students who were successful beg to go back. So we have to look at how can we create additional options, some smaller settings, some smaller opportunities that aren't just like a 1 year or a 2 year or even just a quarter or a two quarter. Because we, in a large setting in larger buildings, we don't have enough to meet that constant need. You're welcome.
Ms. Rowe?
Mm-hmm.
Do you see, with the population of students that you feel the discipline policies don't apply to, do you see any other correlative factors, such as are they behind in their academics? Do they have repeat situations with the Department of Juvenile Services? Is there anything that correlates, or is it just random all over the map across the population? We just occasionally get kids who have these problems. And the other question I have is, it sounds like you're suggesting some sort of a permanent alternative program as opposed to temporary alternative programs.
I'll answer the first question first. I don't have the statistics in front of me. I can tell you that the vast majority are male. So it is definitely we're seeing more violent behaviors from our male students than our female students. But I won't guess on the other statistics. To answer the other question, it is a slippery slope, so I want to be very careful in saying permanent alternative options, because I do think that there are interventions and there are students who can go and then can return, and an intervention can be effective, and that's it. So it's as I said, it's slippery, because we don't want to make a recommendation for a student that permanently excludes them from a comprehensive program. Because we don't always know, but I think that it still has to be there, still has to be processes. There have to be some other choices when it becomes a pattern that we just can't seem to break.
And you don't feel we have anything like
that? I do not, not at this time.
Mr. Offerman.
Yes, given the reality of the situation short term right now, that it's unlikely that we're gonna be able to create things over the, a short period of time. What additional resources would you like to have in your building that would help you at least deal with some of these issues? Or are there any additional resources that you see that would be possibly effective in helping?
I think that some of the additional resources that have been requested over the last few years are trying to meet that need. So we are seeing an increase in counselors. We are seeing an increase in social workers. And those are starting to try to help us meet some of those needs within our building. So beyond that, at this current moment, I can't put a finger on it. I think that our mindset and where we're going is in the right direction, but I still think we have to go just beyond the people that we're putting into our spaces.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Ms. Pescher, did you have any questions at this time? Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome, thank you.
We're gonna move to our next speaker, Ms. Jeanette Young from ESPBC. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, everyone. Okay. Thank you for the opportunity to have ESPBC as a part of the conversation around student discipline. ESPBC representatives are the paras, health assistants, interpreters, technicians, and office professionals employed by Baltimore County Public School. Discipline is a topic, it's Discipline is a topic that is part of the conversation with all the school-based staff. The paraeducators realize the need for changes. They are physically assaulted, cursed, and ignored by students when they attempt to correct inappropriate behavior. On top of that, they have been stripped of their authority to write up a student for acting in an inappropriate manner. The current practice requires parents to inform the classroom teacher, ask him or her to file an office referral on the student. The interpreter also works closely with the students too in the classroom and experience similar interaction with students as it relates to student discipline. Office professionals are often the ones who are left supervising students once they are sent to an administrator. I know this does not make sense because student supervision is nowhere in the job description of an office professional. It happens far more frequently than you may think. As the students wait to meet with the counselor, behavior interventionist, the assistant principal, or the principal, where do they sit? The front office. What happens if the administrator has to go to an observation or do lunch duty? The student sits in the front office. Could you imagine the disruption to your workflow if every minute you are checking on a student to ensure the student is safe or doing their work or eating their lunch? It's difficult. I've highlighted the problem. Quite honestly, I don't have a solution. Instead, I have something for you to consider as you look at Board Policy Rule 5500 and 5550. Consider a plan with any adults who interact with students has equal discipline authority. Consider a plan where there are more defined consequences for negative behavior infraction. The perception of the staff is that the administrator are either only able to have a conversation and blame the staff for not being more understanding of the student and building a better relationship. Consider a plan where all the staff are trained in student behavior, de-escalation, or any of the other best practices in interactions with students. As I offer each of these suggestions, I am more than willing to continue our suggestions and offer suggestions and insight. As if there's a system where students have the capacity to learn effectively, then Baltimore County will continue to strive as a great place for students. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Young. Are there questions or comments for Ms. Young? Ms. Rowe?
I would just like to know if we could have your written statements to refer back to.
Yes.
Thank you. Anyone else? Ms. Young, I had a question.
Yes.
So when you're mentioning the students that may be called to the office for misconduct and that they're sitting in the office waiting to interact with the appropriate person, whether it's the assistant principal or behavior therapist, so what you're saying is that the office personnel are
supervising? Yes.
But that they don't have authority or discipline?
They do not.
So is that... Do you know how often that happens or how widespread that is?
I don't have a number on that data. However, I know it many, many times the elementary schools are more prevalent in that because there's fewer professional staff to address things that are occurring. So the students are left there. Oftentimes in elementary schools, students are left there because they missed their bus. No one has picked them up. So some of those same students who are suspended from the bus, they're sitting there. So the office staff have to address those students while the administrators are out on bus duty trying to get the other students home.
So it's a timing issue where there are...
There are peak times, one would say, morning arrival before students may go to a class for whatever reason that may be. The student may not be ready to go to classroom. During lunchtime when administrators are in the cafeteria, during peak times when administrators are administering observations, students are sent to the classroom, to the office, and then at the end of the day.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you very much. And for our next speaker, if I could have Mr. Fahey from AFSCME.
Good evening, and thank you for having me here today. I figured that most of the behavior in the schools would be covered, so I was going to address disruptive behavior on the school buses. Disruptive behavior on the school bus is not only a discipline issue, but a safety issue. Distractions for the driver can lead to an accident. I understand that policies and rules may have to be applied differently to special needs children. Special attention must be given to safety of adults as well as children on the bus. If a bus driver or bus attendant write too many referrals, they are told, pick your battles. Policy 5500, I would like to see that students who violate code of conduct shall, not may, be disciplined. Rule 5500, I would like to see printed copies of student handbook, not parents and students being told to go online. It has been more than 10 years since the last update. Abiding by bus procedures includes getting to bus stop on the correct side of the road on time in the morning, getting off at assigned stop only, and not crossing the road before the bus is pulled away in the afternoon. Policy 5500, many main problem on bus, school bus, is disrespect and insubordination. I've seen many drivers and attendants in tears because of the names they're being called by students when they are just performing their job. Supervisors have responded by saying that is their culture. I don't think it's anybody's culture. Students see that driver is powerless and continue bad behavior. Inappropriate language and bullying that is not addressed quickly leads to fighting on the bus. I have noticed that the really disruptive students are the ones that get a hug from administrators when they get off the bus at school. The same students get rewarded if there's no report of bad behavior. The other students notice this, and if they need attention, they know how to get it. Rewarding bad behavior is part of the reason why this situation has gotten out of control. Thank you.
Thank you. Board members, do you have questions or comments for Mr. Fahey? Ms. Rowe?
Can you expound on the frequency of fights on the bus?
There are some particular schools, and you know, I can't name any, but there are some particular schools whom there's a lot of fights. There's a lot of bad behavior. People are standing up, you can't see what's going on. I mean, I regularly see some kids punching other kids, but I don't know their names. There are so many kids on the bus, I can't do a referral because I don't know what their names are. If I ask them for their names, and these are elementary kids, if I ask them for their names, they'll give me a wrong name. And none of the other kids will tell me the right name. So I'm pretty much powerless. They refuse to give me their name. So there's nothing I can do.
So are you not provided, do you not have a roster with names of the children who ride that route?
Yeah, but they're not assigned seats, and you don't know which one is which. If you have 60 kids on the bus, there's just too many kids on the bus. And you can't, if you were to try to go through the roster and go to each kid as they came on, it would delay the buses, and we can't do that.
So if there's certain buses that and routes that this is a problem, what is it feasible to say that we could have aides on certain buses but not necessarily need them on all of them?
You wouldn't need them on all of them. And let me, one day the principal of a certain school, elementary school, rode the bus home because the kids were so bad, and for quite a time. And she was sitting about three seats from the back of the bus. Well, there was a kid one seat behind her who had his leg out the window, and she didn't see it. I had to tell her, this kid behind you has his leg out the window. But if I'm concentrating on the kids on the bus, then I'm not looking forward.
Other board members? Mr. Fahey,
thank you.
You had mentioned something about being too many kids, and Ms. Rowe had talked about the potential of aides helping on the bus. Is it, in your opinion, overcrowding of the buses leads to more disruptive interaction between the students?
Very much so. There's what's not taken into account when you know, you sign so many kids on the bus. I mean, even elementary kids, some of these kids are pretty big for elementary kids, and you couldn't have even more than two of those in a seat. Some, I mean, the smaller ones can fit three to a seat. But you also, you got to take into account the their book bags and stuff they're carrying with them, maybe instruments. And instruments is another issue when you get to, like, larger instruments. You don't know what's inside of those. So that's something, that's a different topic, though.
So you had mentioned updating something that had not been updated in 10
well,
years.
Well, the Parents and Students Guide to Transportation updated 2008. And most of the pamphlets from that, this was November 2008, so it's more than 10 years for that.
And that's what you were referencing is available online? Now?
I think it's available online, but, you know, that's what I've been told before by administrators, that this is not given out. Printed copies, this is not always given out, that they're told to go online and look it up.
Okay, I see. So your suggestion would be to make sure that that gets updated and then also handed
out. And printed in physical, and get the parents to sign for it to know that they have it, because the rules in there about crossing the street, which, you know, nobody seems to know anymore.
Okay, that's very helpful, because
okay,
we do want to keep our children safe getting to and from school.
Crossing the street, when, you know, Baltimore County is different than some of the other counties in that the kids are supposed to wait on the side of the street until the bus pulls off. Some of the other counties have the bar in front of the bus, and they allow the kids to stop on the stop sign. In Baltimore County, the kids are not supposed to stop with that stop sign out. They're supposed to wait until the bus leaves so they have a clearer vision.
Okay, I see. That's good to know.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And next we have Ms. Abby Baton, president of TAPCO. Good evening. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me. I am not going to read this because you all have a copy of it, but I'll just kind of paraphrase what's in here. I have talked to this board for a long time about the issues of discipline, so you've heard me, and if you have questions about that, I'm happy to answer them. One of the things that we understand is this whole 5500 policy is, as I wrote in here, contains some of the most important language in all of the policies. And it takes time to make these changes, and we have been working with Baltimore County officials to do this, and I don't want to see it rushed. And we want to make sure that as we do this, we make sure that the changes that we make are changes that are going to make changes for our students, for our staff, to keep everyone safe, to keep discipline at a minimum. So one of the things that we are especially concerned about is zero tolerance. And we've heard language about zero tolerance, but we have seen how harmful that can be to our students, and it does not answer the questions that we need answered, and it's also our neediest students that that suffer from that. So over time, they've proven to be some of the most unfair, divisive, and even cruel directives. So it would be very, very concerning to us, and we would fight against anything like that. We have also been working with the school system folks for well over a year now. Is it going as fast as we want? No. But that said, we understand how important this is. And the policies that address behavior plans and so forth are in your policy. And it's also in our master agreement. And we are working together. We still need some information from Baltimore County, which is being gathered now, so that we have the information about what's going on in each school, because this is a school issue. And we want to see consistency, and we want to make sure that we are working toward what is going to help our neediest students as well. So when we say that we need more hands on and smaller class sizes, it doesn't have to be the same for every child, but for those children that need to be in that setting, that's what we want to see, because it's why we've pushed so much for having those extra sets of hands. So at this point, we would urge you to not make any changes to this policy until we have been able to finish our work so that it really is going to be in the best interest of our students and our faculty.
Thank you. Questions? Ms. Rowe?
I need some help with the term zero tolerance. Can you please unpack exactly what that means and exactly what types of things you would not want to see in the policy?
So I'll give you an example of something that I saw a couple years ago. A fire bell. If a student pulls a fire bell, the student would have to be expelled and possibly looked for an alternative solution for where they have to learn, an alternative school of some sort. I will tell you that as a kindergarten teacher and a pre-kindergarten teacher, there would be a kindergartner who says this sign and it says pull, and that kindergartner pulls it. A zero tolerance would make sure that that child would have to be expelled as well. That's a perfect example of it.
So policies where there's not discretionary flexibility, is that the gist?
We expect people to be, our students to be held accountable for what they do, but depending on their circumstances depends on what is appropriate for one child over another.
So to dovetail with that, one of the main differences is the word shall versus may. So where in the policy, certain places it says a student may be expelled, that leaves the decision making to the principal in most cases of how that policy is applied.
Right. So let me just answer that a little bit because I hear that a lot. It's true that may gives the opportunity for somebody not to be expelled for pulling a fire bell. However, one of the things that we are pushing for and working toward is to make sure that every school has a behavior discipline plan that has been put together by the administration and the faculty council as it is spelled out in our master agreement. When that happens, it then has to be followed with fidelity. We're finding that that's not always happening within the schoolhouse. So we do have schools where we're not having the same difficulty as others, and it's not always a school in what is termed the better areas, because it so often has to do with the faculty working together with the administration to make sure that they have a really good plan and they follow it, and they fix it and tweak it when it needs to be tweaked so that the children know what to expect. It is the expectations of this is what's going to happen. It is the consistency that needs to be in place. It does not mean zero tolerance. It's very different from zero tolerance.
Ms. Rowe, does that answer your question about zero tolerance? Okay. And that's a very important point that you bring up in terms of implementation. Mm-hmm. So here in the Policy Review Committee, we're responsible for analyzing, evaluating policies, perhaps amending them, working with staff who bring us recommendations, and then we move them out to the full board for consideration. They go through first reader, second reader, where there's public input, and then third reader for the vote. And then there's the superintendent's role, and then, as you said, there's the school plans. So there is the issue of implementation and where is the oversight into consistent application of the policies. The policies may be fine.
Right.
And it's a matter of the consistent application. Mm-hmm. And also making sure that the rules align with the policies.
Absolutely. And so that is what we have been working toward with the school system. So we do have TABCO members that have been serving on some of the committees, but it has to go further, and we really are working toward making sure that we even need a grasp on, so how many schools actually do have policies in place that were formed jointly, and are they being updated? or are they 10 years old? And cell phone policies, for instance, are really, really problematic. But what might work in one high school might look very different in another middle school, which might look very different from another elementary school, or even high school to high school. So there are differences that have to be taken into account. So we need to make sure that we're doing that, but we also need the data to do some of the work.
Now, when you say the plans developed jointly, who specifically do you mean should be involved?
It's the administration and the faculty council. There's usually a discipline team that's put together, and that is put together with the faculty council and the administration. That is how it's supposed to happen. That's what it says actually in your policies, but it also says it in our master agreement.
And are those usually developed over the summer?
It really depends on the school. Sometimes it's in the summer, sometimes it's in the beginning of the year, and it depends. If they already have one, the work is not quite as difficult as just starting from scratch. We do have some templates that we can share with the various schools. We go in, our Uniserv directors go in and do work with the faculty councils and the administration to make sure that they're trained as to how to go about what they're doing.
And when you're talking about the work of TABCO, you're talking about the Discipline Action Committee?
That is one group, but within each school, there is the faculty council. Usually the head rep is on that as well, but they're not always the chair of the faculty council. That can be someone else. But that, and it has to be with the administration. This is everybody pulling together to make sure it works.
Yes, absolutely. Okay, does anyone else have questions? Ms. Adekoya?
Would you be open to students being among the groups that eventually makes the discipline policies?
I don't think that's a problem at all, especially at the high school, possibly the middle school level. At elementary, it really depends on the student body. Sometimes some of the intermediate level students might be able to do that as well.
And just to be clear, you're talking about school discipline plans that are for each individual school?
Yes.
Okay. And then the policies are started here.
Right, but the discipline plan has to adhere to your policies and then to the superintendent's rules.
Okay. So that's something that the faculty council could consider, how to incorporate or identify a student volunteer to do the work?
It would be the administration and the faculty council together.
Okay.
It should not be one over the other. It should really be both.
And each school has student leadership. They have student government and student councils.
So. Most of them do, I would think.
Okay, that's great. Anything else, Lily?
Do you have any recommendations, or does TABCO have any recommendations at this time to the discipline policy or additional policies that might make this, the plans that are at schools, better?
We don't have language changes at this point. However, one of the things that we did notice is and I don't have them in front of me, but a few of them, like two or three of the different policies, kind of go toward this, but it's stated a little differently. So in 5500 and 5510 and 5530, and I don't know that those are the three, but there is a mention of these committees that form the plan, but they're just a little different in each one the way it is. So if there was anything that I would talk to you about, it would be a little more consistency in what you're talking about, and some mention that it is supposed to be put together, not just the administration, but this is school-wide. It's supposed to be faculty councils with the administration putting it together.
So we need language to explain what these school discipline plans are, and then who's involved in putting them together, and then make sure that language is consistent across the policies?
Again, here's the concern I have. Policy is here, rules are here, and then of course the schools are tasked with making that happen. if the policy is less than broad and says it has to look like this, then this school might have it this way, and because your policy says that everyone has to look like that, it becomes really problematic. So I would rather that some of that lives in the rule, where there's a little more flexibility, where if you're working on it and you're finding out that my school, Timber Grove is my home school, is trying to do this, but they need this kind of flexibility, they can go to the superintendent and say, you know, the way that rule is written, we're not able to do this, this, and this. We would really, that is, to me, more of the purpose of what it should be, not necessarily in the policy itself.
Okay, so what you're saying is there are places in our current policies where the school disciplinary plans are kind of mentioned, but maybe not with the same language. And you just want us to change that to be similar language so that it's clear what we mean?
Right.
Can you provide at some point
yeah,
a list of those citations?
I have them back there, as a matter of fact.
Oh, well, thank you.
I can tell you which ones they are and where it is in them.
Okay.
Anything else? Thank you very much, Ms. Baton. That's very helpful. We really appreciate all of you coming forward.
Did I have enough for everybody? Did everyone get a copy?
Oh, excuse me, one more question.
Oh, no, it's not for you. I have a question in general.
Okay.
When the stakeholders were being decided for the beginning stages of talking about the discipline policy project, were students ever considered to be involved?
You're here. You're here as the student voice, absolutely.
Unfortunately, as much as I'm here, I believe there needs to be more of me here.
Well, this is not the only meeting that we're going to have on policy review. So it is possible for us to invite more stakeholders. I think it's a good idea to do that, and certainly adding student groups, maybe Baltimore County Student Council, is that what you're thinking, or?
No, actually non-traditional students who are actually affected by discipline policies every day.
Okay, because I was thinking too, we might do something along parent contributions, PTA, things like that. So we can talk about that, and Mr. Offerman and I can evaluate that when we set the agenda for the next meeting. So just email us your ideas. That's great, thank you. So Ms. Baton, I just wanted to make sure that you had the opportunity to update us with your, any update from the Discipline Action Committee. So if you feel that you've covered that, that's fine.
We've been working with Dr. Martin Knox, and we are trying to gather a lot of the information that we talked about. Not sure of the timeline yet, but those are things we're working on. One of the things that I wrote in what I gave you is this has to take time.
Ms. Baton, if you can come to the microphone, please. Thank you.
So it's taken a long time for us to get where we are, and it's going to take a while to fix the problems. And we will probably try things that we think will work, and unintended consequences as they crop up make it so that we might need to change where we're moving. We have been working on the manual that is available as well, but until we have the time to do this, and as I said, it was over a year already, but I don't want this rushed because everyone says we have to fix it. We have to do it in the manner that it's going to make it the most useful for all of us, and so that our children can thrive no matter who they are. And so that is something that, if nothing else, that I hope you hear, that it's better for us to take the time to do this correctly than to rush it.
Okay, thank you. And Dr. Martin Knox is on our agenda for in just a few minutes. So I did want to point out that with the policies, we have to align all of our policies with law, whether it's federal law, state law, MSDE regulations. So if in fact our policies are substantially out of date, then we may need to move forward to having those brought up to date sooner rather than later. But I think one of the things that's important that Ms. Baten brought up along those lines is that there is policy, and there's also the superintendent's rule, and there's also the procedures and the school plans that are put into place, so that there's layers of influence on these issues in order to make the classroom safe, in order to have the children safe on the buses, in order for our support personnel to be safe as they do their important work in the school system. I did want to give a little background. Staff has compiled information binders to assist this committee in the review of the policies. Prior to the meeting, a binder was distributed to each board member. The school system's current discipline policies, along with the current drafts, are behind number two in your binders. And background for the newer committee members. In the school year 2016-2017, the Policy Review Committee reviewed policies 5550, 5560 three times, and on February 13, 2017, moved the policies forward to the board for approval. At its meeting on April 18, 2017, the board removed the discipline policies from the agenda prior to third reader pending a public hearing. That public hearing was held then in October of 2017, and comments were received. Then at its July 10, 2018 meeting, the board directed the Policy Review Committee to review the disciplinary policies and consider input from the Superintendent's Council and the newly established School Climate, Student Behavior, and Discipline Citizens Advisory Committee. In the October meeting, the committee agreed to focus its efforts on two main policies, Policy 5550, Disruptive Behavior, and Policy 5560, Suspensions, Assignment to Alternative Programs, or Expulsions. That's all one policy, 5560. Following finalization of these main policies, we will be able to then make any necessary revisions to the ancillary policies. In fact, several of the policies have been reviewed as recently as 2 years ago and may not require much attention. So are there any questions on that background? Okay. So the next segment of our work is the discipline work group. And also, I want to advise all of the members of the committee that copies of the agenda and the meeting summaries of the Superintendent Student Behavior and Discipline Council are found at tab 21 in your discipline binders. And staff is here tonight to provide an update on that work of the Superintendent's Discipline Work Group. And so I welcome Dr. Penelope Martin-Knox. Thank you. Dr. Knox, can you introduce your staff?
Sure, Ken. So good evening, members of Policy Review Committee. For those of you whom I've not had the fortunate opportunity to meet, my name is Penelope Martin-Knox, and I'm the Chief of School Climate and Safety. Joining me this evening, I have several representatives within the division. If you guys would stand up and introduce yourself, I would greatly appreciate it. We can start with Dr. Nieves.
Good afternoon. I'm Amalio Nieves, and I am the Executive Director for Social Emotional Support.
Thank you for being here.
Good afternoon, April Lewis, Executive Director, Department of School Safety.
Thank you for being here.
Good afternoon, Kim Ferguson, Director of Student Support Services.
Thank you for joining us.
Good afternoon, Sharon Brinkley Parker, Director for School Climate.
Thank you.
Hello, Patricia Mustafer, Coordinator of School Social Work and Multi-Tiered Systems of Support.
Thank you very much for being here.
Good afternoon. Kevin Robertson. I'm the coordinator of Pupil Personnel Services and Responsive Student Programming.
Great to see you. Thank you.
So as a collective group, we work with our students, our stakeholders, our teachers, and our parents to continue to move the work forward as it pertains to student behavior and discipline. Mrs. Causey shared with you some of the work that has taken place over the years as we continue to make adjustments to the policy, but keeping in mind that we take our guidance from the federal government, from the federal level as well as the state level, and making adjustments as we move forward. For the 2018-2019 school year, the superintendent provided a charge for us to engage all stakeholders as we continue to do work around our policies. This actual committee is called the Superintendent Student Behavior and Discipline Council, and we meet quarterly. The charge has been for us to meet quarterly, again, to engage all stakeholders who are participating in meaningful discussion around our policies, the implementation, and effective practices that that will allow us to better meet the needs of our children while also attempting to keep them in class and in school and learning. What has been provided to you in the documents that Ms. Causey referred to a few moments ago, you have a set of notes that are just a synopsis of some of the conversations that have taken place. As I indicated, we do meet quarterly, but as you will see, we've met a total of 3 times this year. The first meeting was actually established so we can create the norms and share with the group what the charge is. Before the superintendent established the Division of School Climate and Safety, there was work that has also taken place prior to the Superintendent Student Behavior and Discipline Council. That work took place last year under the direction of Dr. Mary McComas and Dr. Melissa Limbo-Wisted, engaging again with our stakeholder groups as well as TABCO regarding our policies. If you look at the summaries for each one of the meetings, there is a synopsis, and what we try to do is to make sure that everyone who has been identified as a participant always has the opportunity to engage in dialogue, whether they're able to be there physically present or if someone is not able to make it. We've provided several venues for our participants to engage in. So we actually have a Padlet. In the notes that you have, there are comments that you may see. We also have established a Schoology site for all to engage in conversation, in dialogue, and have access to the materials if they were unable to make it, or even if they were able to make it, they can review those documents. One of the things that we've attempted to do through the Superintendent's Student Behavior and Discipline Council is really engage our participants in research. You have copies of articles that we've utilized that focus on effective practices and research-based practices that will help shape our thinking and our input. At one point, we provided the board with our framework for school climate, and we have an emphasis and a focus on prevention, restoration, and logical consequences. And the prevention piece is, what do we do as educators and leaders to prevent our students from displaying behaviors that could be deemed as disruptive and may need to be addressed through the discipline practice? When we talk about restoration, we really are talking about how we can mend those relationships and help students as we transition them back into the schoolhouse if the removal from the schoolhouse or from the classroom was warranted due to behaviors. Those are also considered the logical consequences when we talk about students being removed from school. As we know, discipline is about educating our children. It is not about the punitive practices. I believe earlier Ms. Baton shared with the Policy Review Committee about zero tolerance. Oftentimes we'll hear that there should be zero tolerance, which means the immediate removal of children regardless as to the behaviors that they've engaged in. And whatever their discipline records may look like, those matters are not being given equitable consideration when we are addressing student behaviors. One of the guidelines that was provided by the federal and state is to make sure that principals have the flexibility to engage students when it's time for them to identify what practices will guide their decision in terms of the consequences, the logical consequences. So the policies that you see before you, again, as they have continued to evolve, we have come to the table several times to make adjustments to those policies to make sure that there's consistency and alignment. If you take a moment to look at October the 10th, again, as I stated earlier during that meeting, it was about establishing norms so that everyone who comes to the table has the opportunity to share and that we are respectful in listening to the those persons as they are presenting. Looking at October the 24th, during that time, the expectations were reestablished, and we again looked at the climate framework to discuss the prevention, logical consequences, and restoration. That again is our framework that shapes the work that we're engaging in when it comes to the policies. On January 16th, we had the opportunity to meet, and the Council read an article, Auditing Your School Climate, the First Steps to Achieving Safer and Higher Performing Schools. That article has also been provided to you. And as I stated earlier, when we are engaging in conversation, we like to also make sure that we have research to support the work that we're engaging in. We have come to the conclusion through discussion with the council that we recognize that one size does not fit all. So that means that there has to be a level of flexibility for our school administrators to levy those consequences to students when they are appropriate. There's also a framework in here that was also shared where, again, we focused on the logical consequences and the restoration because it's about repairing and restoring the relationships and the behaviors when students are returning back to class. If you look, there's a chart that has also been provided. The last meeting we had, we actually discussed the three policies that you see in the chart or the graph. Policy 5500, 5550, and 5560. Now, I'll just give you an idea of what the meeting looked like when we shaped the meeting. We were able to divide the group into three equitable groups so that it wasn't a large group discussion, and we had the opportunity to hear the voice of all of our students, teachers, administrators, and community members. You will see on the chart, you will see the recommended changes that were presented by each one of the groups and that has been captured here that will also shape the work as we continue to revise and look at our policies. So one of the things that you can see that was a recommended change in policy 5500 is to add professional learning for our principals regarding an integrated program to deal with student behaviors. The group felt that it was most important that not only are we providing professional opportunities for our teachers, but as Ms. Astorita said earlier, that we must also provide those opportunities for our principals. When we look at the Code of Student Conduct, that is something that Ms. Baton spoke of a few moments ago, just making sure there's consistency across our schools and making sure there's a working relationship with faculty councils as we're developing those discipline plans within each one of our schools. When we examine the potential implications, there was a recommendation for us to review and consider the intersectionality of policies 5500 and 5510. We will continue to have those conversations the next time we come back together as a group. In policy 5550, the recommended change was very, very meaningful and powerful, as the group felt as though the title of the policy is outdated. One of the specific examples that was provided, again, aligns itself to what Ms. Astorita shared earlier. The group felt that the behaviors that we described years ago may not be the same behaviors we see today. So instead of calling the policy disruptive behavior, there should be an emphasis on the mental health and well-being of our students. The identification of meaningful resources so that our leaders have a bank of resources to utilize and to refer to when making those decisions and dealing with students. And again, it's about changing the behavior and making sure we're educating our children beyond the scope of the schoolhouse so that they're productive citizens. And the time for appropriate placement, the group felt that sometimes it was too long before we made a determination when a student faced a long-term suspension, that the time frame was just a little too long for us to make a final decision. And finally, we discussed policy 5560. There was a recommendation that in section 5D of the policy that there was a merger of numbers 1 and 2, and it was specific to the conferring with the teacher. The language actually states that when a teacher has to deal with a student and removing the student from the class, that the teacher is conferred with. But there was also language in that policy that talks about when a student is suspended or a consequence is levied that removes him or her from the schoolhouse, that the teacher is also conferred with. So that language was recommended to be merged together. There was also a recommendation, again, Ms. Baton mentioned this earlier, that there should be a set of guidance documents or set of resources that are developmentally appropriate when it comes down to dealing with students and their age or the appropriateness of their age at that particular point in time. And finally, in Section D, we spoke about this earlier, it's conferring after the word meeting. It was duplicated several times within the policy, and the group recommended that there's an adjustment to that that should be made. And so the other implication is making sure that the language is tied to COMAR. And when we talk about COMAR, we're actually talking about 13A, 08, 01, 11, which is the requirements of disciplinary action as it relates to COMAR. So again, on the next page, you have language from the Padlet that our members actually were excited to engage in because many of them had never heard of a Padlet. So it was a learning opportunity for us. And again, the articles that we've shared during the times of our sessions or our meetings are also provided. We do have two more meetings that are scheduled. One was canceled or rescheduled as a result of the snow, and we meet in March, and then we will also have another meeting in April. The meetings go very, very well. I will say that each of the participants is engaged in the work and is very passionate about what it is we do for children to make sure we keep them in school as much as we possibly can, because we do know that the more students are removed from school, the more their academic and their learning is impacted and affected.
Thank you, Dr. Martin Knox. Are there questions? Okay. I did have a question. So you said the next meeting is in March?
Yes, ma'am.
And then again in April?
Yes, ma'am.
Had this information been given to Ms. Howie earlier? Or I guess I'm wondering if you've had an opportunity to review this. Okay. In looking at policy 5550, I see that it hasn't been updated. Excuse me, 5500 since 2015. So, Ms. Howie, I'm looking for your comments as to how much the law has changed since 2015, and whether we are significantly out of compliance with recent laws that it would be important to get in line.
Well, as you will recall, Ms. Causey and members of the committee who were here before, we did have a presentation from the Public Justice Center about changes to statute and to regulation, and about their opinion, certainly, about our alignment or lack of same with respect to our policies, our student discipline policies. So there are some changes that are clearly being recommended by one of the advocacy groups, but they do have clear alignment with what is now in the Code of Maryland Regulations.
So you're saying they are in alignment now, or they're not? Okay.
I'm confused about what you said. Then I said it well.
So, as I indicated, the Public Justice Center was kind enough to present at one of our PRC meetings concerning our compliance with the current regulations and whether or not the current regulations are in alignment with our policies. So we have gotten that information from some very diligent advocacy groups who assist us in representing students.
So it's always good. We might be out of compliance.
It's always good to listen to people who have interests that are aligned with our students, and to try to incorporate to the best way possible what their suggestions are. Let's put it this way. Our policies were last revised prior to the new regulations being put on the books.
Okay. So,
I'm sorry, Mrs. Causey. I stand to be corrected. My staff, thank you for correcting me. I did state that the next meeting was in March, in specific, it's March 6th. And to Mrs. Howie's comment a few moments ago, we actually have that organization presenting to the group because it is very important for us to hear when we have those who are advocates for our children and to make sure that we are moving in the right direction, so that those two organizations will be presenting at our next meeting. And the next meeting is not in April, but instead it's in May, May 15th.
So you're having a meeting March 6th and May 15th?
Yes, ma'am. And the calendar invites were recurring, so every participant knows when those meetings are. So if you'd like to participate, let me know, and I'll make sure you have access.
Okay, that is helpful. Also, for Policy Review Committee members, but also any member of the public that may be watching this meeting now or later, the same organization did present to Policy Review Committee in October. So if you want to go to the board website under Board Leadership and board committee meetings, it is there in the video minutes that can be watched. And it is a very informative presentation. I guess one of the suggestions that I would want to make is that we do have another policy review committee meeting March 11th, and then another one the next month in April. I think it may be helpful for this committee to have staff incorporate recommendations made to date into our main policies, because we, as a policy review committee, may want to analyze those and move those forward to the full board, where there will be additional analysis, additional time for public input, because it is important to get our policies in alignment with the law and with COMAR. So while there are additional issues and situations that we can work on at a slower pace, including rules and evaluate implementation of those rules, and if they're in alignment with policy, I think it is important to get our policies in alignment sooner rather than later. Is that okay? And I'd like to make that a motion. And is there a second? Okay, discussion?
Are you referring to the same rules that Ms. Bateman said that we should take time on, like 5,500?
Ms. Bateman?
That one doesn't work, sorry. We were not referring to anything that would be tied to COMAR. Obviously, our policies should actually be exactly what they are stated as COMAR. That was not the information that we were discussing. But I have two other things. I do have the two sections you asked for, and it was two, not three, sorry, but it was 5,500 section 4C and 5,510 section 1B. Mm-hmm. And one other thing, and if you'll just bear with me, you happen to mention March 11th as your next meeting, and I respectfully ask that you change that, because that is our march to Annapolis, and I'm hoping that many of you will be joining us.
Thanks to Mr. Offerman and our wonderful staff. We have already taken care of that, and I will be announcing later, but we are moving our meeting up, so it's in the morning. So that we will be able to join you. Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Ms. Howie, I would just, before we get back to discussing the motion, I would like staff to, in evaluating the policies, to bring forward those that are the main ones that are the furthest out of compliance.
Understood.
And is there a discussion to the motion that's on the floor?
I'd like for you to clarify your motion. What is it exactly you want them to do?
Well, we've heard from TABCO and AFSCME and ESPBC. And CASE, we've also heard from Dr. Penelope Martin Knox with the work of that discipline council. And routinely, our law office staff revises policies to align them with federal law, state law, and COMAR. So we would be asking our staff to incorporate recommendations and perhaps making footnotes as to where those recommendations came from, so we could outline from where they came specifically, so that the Policy Review Committee can review those new proposed policies for consideration. Any further discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. The next item on our agenda is policy 8130, formulation, and presenting is Ms. Howie.
Thank you, Ms. Causey. Members of the committee, I'll direct you to tab 3 of your binders, and you also received a supplemental document this afternoon. So, just by way of preface, I call policy 8130 the policy about policies. It's a bureaucrat's dream. And as well, by way of preface, you have in policy 8130 some standards that have been established concerning how policies are presented and when they are presented. So you currently have in your policy a 5-year cycle, so that policies need to be reviewed every 5 years. You also have in 8130 specific ways in which policies are brought forward to you. So as you've seen in the policies that were brought forward for your consideration in this tab, for example, there's a policy analysis, which explains what the issues are. That policy analysis also, again, as a result of your policy, indicates what the changes are, whether or not there is any cost, and what staff's recommendation is. And finally, there is a recommended timeline as to when the policy will be enacted. And then you have the draft policy. And we include for the PRC members as well a copy of the current policy. Once upon a time here in Baltimore County, and Ms. Pester may remember this, policies were simply presented and there wasn't a particular format. So policy 8130, as I indicated, is the way that you as a quasi-legislative body determine how you want these policies brought to you. You understand, and you've seen in the past couple of months in your board service, that there are 3 times that policies are brought to you for first, second, and third reader. So if and when this committee approves a policy this evening, it will then go to the full board for what we call first reader. And that is simply presentation to the board for the board's consideration. It goes as a committee report. Following first reader, second reader is when policies are presented so that the public can comment. And Ms. Rowe will remember in her days as an advocate presenting public testimony about policies. And then third reader is when the board finally votes on the policies. So let me highlight, first of all, the supplemental document that was provided to you. There are some changes recommended in policy 8130 that would, first of all, outline what first, second, and third reader mean. Right now, there is not a definition of any of those processes in your policy. It's simply been done as a matter of practice. So not a bad idea to outline exactly what your process is. But what I wanted to make sure you were aware of is that based on the way that you're currently scheduling policies for review, let's assume, for example, that tonight you approve policies to go forward for first reader. Your practice, or the board's practice, has been that you only take four policies per board meeting for first reader. That means on first reader, which would come up on the 19th of March, you would take forward four policies. Then the second reader would come up on the 9th of April. Again, those same policies being discussed for public comment. PRC had indicated previously that this committee wanted to review public comment prior to policies being presented again for third reader. So the PRC meeting where that can happen would be May 13th. At that point, if a policy or those four policies are approved to go forward, they would go forward for approval on third reader on June 11th, 2019, from work that you complete tonight. So that's the first possibility. You have on the second page a potential flow chart based on policies coming back to this committee, both after first reader and then after second reader, because that was one of the possibilities that was indicated at the last discussion of this particular policy. So I present that so that the committee is aware that it's a rather time-intensive process, that, again, looking at this possible revised schedule, that policies and then only four policies going forward on the 19th of March from tonight would then not be approved, some of them, until July, and then others of them not until October from tonight's action by this committee. God bless you.
Are there any questions? Ms. Rowe?
So are these the only two options, or does the possibility exist in between first and second reader for the PRC committee to have the option based on comments to bring it back to the committee? So I guess what I'm asking is, do we have to have one or two of these automated systems, or is it possible to continue with the first system but have some mechanism that, should a particular policy be particularly controversial, or should the public come forward with something that we just didn't think about, that we could have the option to pull it back into PRC in between first and second reader, as opposed to having it be an automatic standard thing? Because some policies no one comments on.
That is true. So it's certainly up to the committee what your desire is, but given the length of time that it takes for policies based on your desire in the draft of 8130, I simply wanted to ask the committee's pleasure, given that your staff are all sitting out there, do like to know what policies the board has, because we do want to follow the policies. The superintendent does want to write the rules, and at the school level, at the office level, write the procedures. And given that this is becoming a year-long process, I simply wanted the committee to be aware that the process is becoming more laborious, and wanted the committee to have the opportunity to discuss what you believe your best practices are. I note as well that there was a subcommittee last year that indicated that the board might want to change its cycle from 5 years to 7 years as far as review, automatic review of policies. And that is incorporated in this draft of 8130. Staff is simply asking for direction. If you want the policies brought back to you, staff will bring the policies back to you. But I question whether or not the board's policies that, again, staff needs to know so we know how to go forward, not knowing from March until October whether or not a particular policy is in effect may not be the best way and the most efficient way to use this committee's time. The other question I would have is whether or not indeed the committee wishes to essentially recommit through its own policy. That is, again, something you can do. But usually once a committee has reported out to the full body, to the full assembly, then it's out of the committee's hands, it's in the assembly's hands. So that's something else to consider. In the parliamentary world, it's unusual for a committee to take something back unless the full body recommits to the committee.
So right now, as I understand things, what we do right now is the first flow chart. Is this what you're telling me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so right now, PRC considers public comments in between second and third reader automatically.
It's not a part of your policy, it's a part of your practice.
It's a part of our practice, but that's what we do.
Yes, ma'am.
What is it exactly besides adding a PRC consideration between first and second reader that's turning this into a year-long practice? I feel like I'm missing something.
So in the suggested change, you want, or the desire was,
the desire was that there be consideration between first and second and third. So there is an additional PRC meeting. So policies would be voted out by this committee, sent to full board, sent back, sent to full board, sent back, sent to full board.
Okay, so from my perspective, I don't really want a year-long process for considering policies, for policies that are part of the routine agenda for review. But there's a small number of policies that, as they come forward in the public, become policies that the public cares a lot about and wants to deliberate. And I feel like that we should have some mechanism in this policy that allows us to, for the PRC committee or the full board, however it works, to be able to bring the policies back in between first and second reader if we feel that the public has come up with something that just throws us into left field. The alternative to that would be getting all the way through three readers and then having the full board vote to send it back to PRC, and then the process for that policy starts from the very beginning of deliberation and we have to go through three readers again. So I would think that if you have a situation where there's a possibility that the full board might not be able to approve the policy because of things the community is bringing forward, it actually shortens the process for the PRC to have the option to bring a specific policy which becomes controversial during first reading back into PRC in between first and second reading. But I don't think that we need a mechanism that does that automatically for every single policy.
So second reader, traditionally, again, you can change because you're the board, these are your policies, but second reader traditionally was to allow the public to provide comment. The discussion at the last PRC meeting about this particular policy was that, as you said, sometimes the public might want to see something before it goes before the full board and then comment. Another option that you have, again, these are your policies, you get to decide. Another option is to, given that this is part of your quasi-legislative role, that you act as a legislative committee, as one would happen in the General Assembly, and you receive comments here.
In PRC.
In PRC, that's another possibility, that you have your hearings here, incorporate the comments, and then once they're sent forward, rather than having a three-reader process, you can then perhaps expedite. You wouldn't need three readers because you've already received the comments from the public. That's another possibility.
Okay, so what is the mechanism right now if the board, because of something happening in schools or in the public or whatever, decides that a policy that's not currently in the schedule for automatic review should need to be reviewed?
Well, it happened at, I believe, your first or second board meeting. The board decides to add something to the agenda, or someone makes a motion and commits or directs the committee to study a particular policy. It's exactly what happened with the student discipline policies. As Ms. Causey explained, they were before the board and then sent back to committee.
Okay,
that's not
so
unusual.
It's just a board action.
Yes, ma'am.
Is it necessary for us to make a decision on this policy today?
You are the board committee. So is it bleeding, burning, or screaming, are you asking?
Yes, that's what I'm asking.
I do not believe it's doing any of those, but I do believe that staff would be very appreciative of some sort of guidance as a direction that you would like to take so that we can incorporate any particular edits that the committee so desires.
Well, I think I've said everything I have to say on the subject until someone's ready to motion or vote.
Is there any other discussion on policy 8130? Ms. Howie, if you could just clarify currently policy 8130 as proposed in our blue sheets it outlines the current practice or it outlines?
No, ma'am, this is the new practice based on what the committee directed at its last meeting,
which is the second flow chart.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
And then the 7 years as opposed to the 5 year cycle.
Okay. Then, if no one else has...
Oh, I do have one more question.
Yes, Ms. Rowe.
So, there's a section E, that's being deleted.
Section E is being deleted. Is that being moved to another policy, or is it just being deleted outright? Because I know sometimes when we change policies, it's on the page one. Mm-hmm. It's the board shall approve prior to implementation. Like...
I believe that the thought was that this is part of your authority with respect to curriculum anyway.
Oh, I see.
So it was redundant in this particular policy, given that this policy is about policies.
Okay. I think the only thing I'd like this committee to consider is whether or not we really need an automatic reconsideration of this body for every single policy in between first and second reader. I don't really think we do, but I do think we need a mechanism in the policy that we can bring it in between first and second reader back to the PRC if something happens and we feel like we need to. I don't know what that mechanism would look like, though.
Well, I think you could make a motion to ask staff to amend this policy and bring back another proposed draft at our next meeting.
So moved.
And Ms. Rowe,
you may need
I'm
to clarify that.
Seconded.
Yes.
Well, Actually, in small assemblies, doesn't need to be seconded, so it's simply the assembly's pleasure.
I just would like you to clarify that, because...
So what I would like is for staff to come back with a recommendation for this policy for language, that instead of having an automatic PRC review in between first reader and second reader, that we would have a mechanism to have the option to bring it back in between first and second reader, as opposed to making it part of the automatic process, so that it's at our pleasure to do so.
So between first and second and third?
I like the automatic thing between second and third, but I would like between first and second to be at our pleasure.
And Ms. Rowe, I will have to talk to Ms. Gover, because part of the issue is when things are loaded into board docs, because we do have an obligation under the Open Meetings Act to publish our agendas prior to board meetings. So I'll ask whether or not that's viable, because I'm not sure that it is.
Staff can come back with a variety of recommendations that accomplish the purpose of giving us options, mm-hmm. and also make things streamlined, but give us the ability to consider policies in this way. What I'm trying to do is avoid a situation where we get through an entire deliberation, a three-reader process, and then the board votes the policy down and we have to start over from the beginning.
And I believe one of the issues with this policy was the committee did want the full board to discuss it. The discussion was, or the hope was, that the full board would have had a summer retreat, discussed what the board's desire was, and then incorporated the collective's desire into the policy. Because the retreat did not happen, the policy simply sort of floundered.
Maybe we could add that option, and then...
Which option, ma'am?
The option that I moved to add, and then have that option as one of the options presented to the full board when we discuss this policy. Eventually, we do discuss the policy with the full board, right?
You make a report to the full board through your committee chair, and in the same way that, for example, Building and Contracts makes a report after Building and Contracts has had a discussion, in the same way the curriculum committee makes a report. So you do provide your opinions and your recommendations in that way.
Okay, well, a multiplicity of options is good, I think. I mean, the motion is to ask staff to come up with recommendations that accomplish that, not necessarily that we're making a specific decision on it today. Just to clarify for other committee members.
So I can have many recommendations, but I suppose that what I would appreciate from the committee is whether or not you have a particular desire that I'll then be very happy to turn into an option for you.
I'd like it to be optional, bringing things back in between first and second reader, as opposed to automatic.
So did you withdraw your first motion and this is your...
No, that was the first motion.
Okay.
I'd like recommendations for that option.
Okay. Is there a second? A second for her motion. Okay. Any other discussion?
Does this hinder or affect anything in a negative way?
Thank you for asking. We'll continue in the work, ma'am.
So what it's doing specifically is saying that we do not want to move forward policy 8130 with that second flow chart that then takes 5 to 6 months. So, right. So we're saying that we don't want that, and that per Ms. Rowe's motion, we'll have other recommendations brought forward. Okay. All in favor? Yes. Yes, Ms. Pasture?
Your motion is that not other recommendations, like it just continues to have a life of its own, but one that specifically is speaking to between first and second? Is that what you're saying?
Ms. Howie finds out that because of open meeting acts or putting things on board docs that that's not possible, then we might have to consider something else. But if that's possible and it doesn't violate any laws, then yes, that is the motion for staff to come back with language for the policy that gives us the option of bringing something back in between first and second reader, but not the obligation to.
And I will, I appreciate the clarification, and I will discuss with staff about whether or not we have the dexterity to be able to make those changes between first and second reader, and it's a rather large bureaucracy, and that may be difficult. And again, I'm happy to bring the suggested changes back to you, but I'll also check with Ms. Gover about what that might do to extending your time. Because if the option has to be exercised within a certain amount of time, and let's say that's between your meetings, that is going to just push your process back.
Okay, any other discussion? All those in favor of Ms. Rowe's motion, please raise your hand. Any opposed? The motion carries. Thank you, and we'll move next to our agenda item policy 8222. And presenting again is Ms. Howie.
And thank
for the,
you.
For the board, that's tab 4.
Yes, ma'am. So this policy, again, was taken to the board, returned to the committee for further review. And then, again, the last time this committee reviewed it, the committee asked that what was then House Bill 73 and now part of the education article, Section 3, 2B as in boy 09, which was the Education Transparency Act, that those requirements be incorporated in policy 8222. Specifically, what the most recent recommendation that staff has for this policy is to rename it, then to expand on the duties of the superintendent as executive officer, secretary, and treasurer. And the most recent changes have to do with alignment with the Education Transparency Act. So those are the changes that are new as of this particular iteration of the policy. Then we were also asked at the last PRC meeting to present a cost analysis. In section 2B9, one of the new requirements is that the superintendent keep a transcript of all hearings involving the board, not only your 6202 and 4205 hearings, but any public hearings, and that those transcripts be uploaded to the website. So what staff was able to do, and you have an additional tab 5 table for your review. What staff was able to do was speak to the current vendor that we use for our hearings, for our hearing examiner hearings, and receive the cost estimate based on, first of all, the turnaround time, and second of all, whether or not the board wishes to have a court reporter at the hearing or a court reporter simply listening to your video after the fact. But we were asked to provide a cost estimate. We also provide a cost estimate about hearings as well as meetings, because there was discussion at one point about whether or not the committee wanted board meetings as well as your hearings to be transcribed. So you have both of those numbers.
Ms. Howie, I just had a question. Is there any time frame required by law that we need to consider
for?
For having the transcripts available online or?
Well, the transcripts are our, or the board, through board policy, that's what you're directing be done. Your official minutes would be your minutes. And the Education Transparency Act does require that there be a summary and a description of what's happened at your public meetings posted within 72 hours of your meeting. So I do have copies of the act for the committee, just in case. So the only requirement, time requirement, is set forth in the Education Transparency Act. And that's what indicates that it has to be posted, your description has to be posted within 72 hours. A full and accurate description is the way the statute refers to it. What I've done is just highlighted in green the language that was HB 73 that was that became the Education Transparency Act. As to the transcription, there is no requirement in law. It would be up to, again, the committee as to whether or not you wanted to recommend that a transcription be supplied within a certain amount of time.
Ms. Rowe?
So having a transcription at all, did that originate from changes in the law?
No, ma'am.
What's the background? Why are we discussing this?
That was as far as the transcript or the cost?
Yeah, no, as far as we don't do transcripts now, correct?
Correct.
So why are we contemplating doing transcripts?
That was the recommended language that is in subsection 9. And the follow-up that staff was asked to do was to provide a cost analysis of what providing a transcript, in addition to the video that would be your official minutes of a hearing. That was the request.
Ms. Causey, can you speak to the history of the board on this and what the, I'm having a hard time understanding the thought process of why we would do this when we have video minutes.
The thought process was to increase transparency and ease of access to both board members and staff and the public in terms of finding and locating segments of the meeting and transcripts of what occurred rather than potentially watching hours of a meeting. One could do word searches and so forth to have complete information about what information was given orally at the meetings that's not in board docs, for instance. There's a lot of discussion at meetings that's not in board docs. So the thought process was it would make it more in line with other legislative bodies that have transcripts that are available, Interagency Commission on School Construction, for instance, Board of Public Works, other agencies that have transcripts of their meetings, make it easier for the members, but also staff and the public to go back and understand what occurred at the meetings.
Okay. I don't have a problem with that idea, but can I ask a question about something else in the policy? Or is this not the time for that?
No, sure.
Okay, so when I was reading through this policy and I see the responsibilities of the superintendent, one of the things that I wanted to know is this policy does not seem to speak to the superintendent's facilitating requests by the Office of Internal Audit that the board may send the Office of Internal Audit. And I wanted to know if it's appropriate for that to be in this policy, or is there another policy that already contains that?
I'm not sure I understand the duty that you want incorporated.
So if the board asks for the office internal audit to research something, investigate something, then it's the superintendent's responsibility to aid the office of internal audit in facilitating that request. But I don't see that outlined anywhere in our policies, and I thought that perhaps this would be the appropriate one to outline that, unless you're aware of some other policy which already states that.
Sure, policy 8400.
8400 already
yes,
states
ma'am.
That. Okay, thank you. Then I have no other questions about this policy.
Anyone else have questions? I just had one word inclusion. On page 2, paragraph B, sentence number 3, it's down at line 11.
Mm-hmm.
In collaboration with the board chair and vice chair and upon approval by the board chair, prepare the agenda for each board meeting. The currently in policy 8311, it's up to the board chair and vice chair to approve the agenda. It's not solely up to the board chair. So I think the language should be consistent.
So upon approval of the, by the board chair and
vice
chair.
Chair. Mm-hmm. I'd like to make a motion to amend the policy to include the word vice chair.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, raise your hand. Thank you. So I would like to, I guess Ms. Howie, does the Policy Review Committee need to make a suggestion or a recommendation to the full board on what level of transcription would be sufficient to fulfill this policy, or?
Think that would be wise, yes, ma'am.
Okay, so I would ask my fellow committee members to review this cost estimate and have discussion around which of those we would like to make a recommendation to the full board to fulfill the policy recommendation as it is. Is there a recommendation from my committee members? Ms. Rowe?
Given that we do have the video, I don't feel that having something the same day, the next day, I think the 7 to 10 day delivery is acceptable. And I think that so there's two sections here. One is no court reporter and the transcript is from the video, and one is having a court reporter in the meeting. I think we have to, if we're gonna do this, we have to have a court reporter in the meeting because people don't use their mics, and I've viewed the videos and there are quite often huge gaps in what can be heard on the video. So I think that the least expensive option that meets our needs in the 7 day to 10 day delivery with accuracy is the $38,294.50 option, which has a court reporter in the meetings.
So
for
actually,
an
I think you
transcript.
Mean 6,602.
I'm looking at the total estimated annual cost.
And that would be for just the hearings because.
Oh,
the,
okay.
The policy. There was a discussion about what the cost would be if you included meetings, which is why we gave you both costs. But the policy itself only refers to hearings.
What's the difference then between all meetings and hearings?
Like- so the board meeting that just took place this past mm-hmm. week, there, according to this, would have been a court reporter there.
Mm-hmm.
As opposed to the hearing that took place on Wednesday or Thursday, I believe it was.
Okay, so our full board meetings, there's an option between having our full board meetings have a court reporter and then having everything have
and
a court reporter.
And your I mean, the discussion of your predecessors of the committee was whether or not it made sense to have this extended to every board meeting or simply to the board hearings.
I find it satisfactory if this is for our full board meetings, which I believe is what you're calling a hearing.
No, ma'am, it's not.
Oh, my gosh, I'm so confused. All right, so.
Okay, so on Thursday evening, you had a boundary hearing.
Yes.
Which I understand was very short.
Yes, it was very short.
So the boundary hearing under this policy would have been one that would have been transcribed.
I don't think we need that.
I'm simply saying that based on the way the policy is written, there would have been a court reporter at that hearing.
Where's the option for just the stuff that happens in this room?
You would have to write that for just the stuff that happens in this room.
I mean, like, because I'm fumbling over vocabulary here. I don't see a stenographer as being necessary for anything that happens outside this room.
So you would have to define, because this is direction to your superintendent about what you want the superintendent to do and the superintendent's duties. If it is a hearing, so let's say you have a hearing on the capital or operating budget. That happens in this room.
Oh, I see.
But it is a hearing where, again, the public is invited. You want them to come. You want to hear what they have to say about the capital budget, the operating budget. You want to hear what the public has to say about the upcoming possible changes to boundaries in the Southwest area.
I understand.
Those are all hearings.
Okay, so what about stuff that happens in this room in which board business actually takes place? What's that called?
Well, that's also, that could be a hearing, but it could also be your regular board meetings.
So what Ms. Howie's referencing is, would be the second column, total estimated annual cost based on, excuse me, based on 24 meetings plus 5 work sessions / public hearings. And so that number for, to have a court reporter there would be $38,000 a year.
So the difference is $7,000 between the two?
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry, how did you?
38,000, it's 11,000.
31 to 30.
31 as opposed to 6.
Okay.
Or 38 as opposed to 6, excuse me.
Oh, I was doing the difference between with a court reporter and without a court reporter.
Okay, understood.
Is that,
excuse me, Ms. Rowe, Ms. Adekoya?
Is there any current recommendations or recommendations from our predecessors?
Well, the recommendation was, what was concluded for moving the policy was to have stenographic transcripts made of all public board hearings. But it is up to this committee to decide whether it's important to increase the ability of board members, staff, and the public to be able to go back and understand fully what was discussed at the meetings without having to watch a 3-hour meeting. Any recommendations?
All right, I just have a question.
Ms.
because
Rowe.
I'm not following this chart. What is the difference in cost between a 7 to 10 day delivery of having just meetings versus meetings and hearings?
So,
well, what you would do is subtract the hearing cost from the total of the 24 meetings and hearings cost.
I'm sorry, what was that, John?
I think it's about $6,500.
So so like I said before, okay, so. Let's do everything. That's my opinion.
Yes, I think that's the way to do it. If we're going to have this transparency, then let's have it. So can I make a motion that we go ahead and use the total estimated cost of the annual cost of $38,294 to cover 24 public meetings and the 5 work sessions plus public hearings.
Yes, you may make that motion.
Okay.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any more discussion? All in favor? Please raise your hand. Thank you. Then I would just make a motion that Ms. Howie have staff correct the language in
I would ask that the committee.
We can change it.
Yes.
Because then we can move it out to the full committee, to the full board. So in paragraph 9, where it says maintain accurate records, including a stenographic transcript of all public board hearings, I would make a motion to include and board meetings. Is there a second to my motion? Any discussion? All in favor, please raise your hand. Any opposed? Motion carries. Can I have a motion to now move this to the full board?
Motion.
Second.
All in favor, please raise your hand. Any opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. Is that sufficient for this policy?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, great. Then we're moving forward to policy. It's new business, item 3 on the agenda, and it's policy 2361, which is under tab 6, and presenting is?
Hi, my name is Elisa Alston.
Nice
I'm our senior communications officer from the Department of Communications and Community Outreach. And today we have 2361. The proposal is offering edits that comport with the board's editing conventions.
So, sorry, just by way of explanation, new members of the committee, you do tell the staff how you want policies to look and how you want them to sound. So Mr. Virch, Ms. Causey's predecessor as chair, had a thing about commas. So that was incorporated into the policy editing conventions, and the changes that staff is bringing forward are to align the policy with your convention so that, again, all of the policies look and sound the same.
This is about commas? Is that what you just said?
I'm saying that that's one of the unusual requirements that PRC has. There does not appear to be, there do not appear to be any Oxford commas in this particular policy, but I believe some of the changes that are being brought do have those changes, but not this one, ma'am, no.
Actually, Ms. Howie, there is one Oxford comma being deleted, so.
I did miss it, I'm sorry.
There it is. Does anyone have any questions about this policy? Do I have a motion to move this policy forward to the full board for consideration?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor, please say aye. Any opposed? The motion carries. Moving right along is policy 8132 under tab number 7, and we have Ms. Howie.
Thank you. So, oddly enough, and again, I'll refer to Ms. Pester, and Mr. Offerman may remember this as well. Once upon a time in BCPS, all of your policies were in two binders, and all of your rules were in two binders. Policies were on blue paper, and rules were on yellow paper. And I was told by someone who predated me that the reason that blue and yellow were chosen was that those were the only colors back in the 70s.
There was goldenrod. Wasn't there goldenrod? Am I dating myself?
We did not use goldenrod. We only used blue and yellow. So those policy manuals were in each school, right, each office, and right, we also provided a copy to the public library.
Right.
And then once a year, what the board office would do would be to compile all of the policies that had been amended during that year and send them out en masse to schools and offices. It has only been since 2004 that we've had a policy website. And Ms. Clark, who I'm afraid I neglected to introduce, who's there at the table, who is in the Office of Law and who, without whom many things wouldn't get done. Ms. Clark remembers when staff in the Office of Law and in the superintendent's office spent basically a whole summer digitizing the what was in the policy manual, because the policies just simply weren't in any sort of format. So basically what this, the recommendations to this policy that are presented to you simply indicate how you want your policies available to the public. You just talked about transparency. This simply indicates very minor change that you want the manual online. It is already online. Right. We stopped, I guess, about 7-8 years ago, sending out the hard copies. Right. It really hasn't been that long, but the way that you're providing access to the public of your policies is by having those policies online, and that's simply what this policy talks about.
Any questions or comments? Do I have a motion to move the policy forward to the full board for consideration?
Motion.
All in favor, please raise your hand. Any opposed? Motion carries. That leads us to our next policy, 8250, under tab number 8. And for that, I would ask Ms. Howie to.
Surely. Changes are being recommended to this policy as a result of changes in the law that increase board member compensation and increase as well and set a scholarship amount for the student board member. So this is consistent with Section 3.2B as in boy 06 of the education article.
Are there any questions or comments on this policy?
No.
Ms. Rowe?
So I would like to see one addition to this policy as far as attendance of board members. Under Section 2, we need some kind of language that encompasses not just that board members will attend all meetings, both public and special, but I think that it's important to clearly state that if a board member makes a commitment to attend a public event, that that commitment should be kept.
Or what?
So, for instance, Kathleen and I agreed well ahead of time to judge the VEX robotics competition.
Which was amazing.
Which was amazing. However, I think that they depend on us when we make commitments like that, that we actually do it. And I think that there are certain things like that, that it's important that if a board member commits to do something in the community like that, the policy should state that the board member has an obligation to be there.
And certainly, Ms. Rowe, if you want to include that as a responsibility, however, I believe that this language related to board members' attendance at meetings and the like, as opposed to public events where a quorum is not necessary in order to do business.
Oh, so okay.
So that's the purpose for this specific language, is because of a quorum?
Well, when you look at when you look at subsection 3B, failure to attend scheduled meetings, not scheduled gatherings or events. So if you think
I'm not concerned about removing someone. Concerned about it being important that a person follow through and attend on something like that.
And that may be a separate section. Respectfully, I would recommend that it not be in a meeting section.
Okay.
Because a meeting has to do with you coming together as one body, as opposed to, again, something that the community may expect, but certainly wouldn't prevent the community from going forward.
Okay, do you have a recommendation as to where that language could be put?
May I make a recommendation? I would suggest that we have agreed as a board to modify and revise our board handbook. So I think it would be appropriate to put it in there as opposed to in a policy that's designed to align with law.
I'm content with that.
Is that? Okay, Ms. Adekoya?
In regards to the be granted a scholarship of 1,000, will that be present this year?
The scholarship under the statute is for students who serve after 2018, whose term begins after that point. So it jumps from 100 to 1,000, yes.
Is there any other discussion of this policy? Do I have a motion? Oh, Ms. Rowe?
Ms. Howie?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it possible for the board, through board action, to apply that scholarship to Ms. Adekoya? Or is that not within our purview?
Well, certainly, if the board wishes to grant funds to Ms. Adekoya, it would not be because the law indicates. It would be because you are directing that that be done as a policy, or obviously as individual members of the board, you can certainly make donations to Ms. Adekoya. I do not believe that would be inconsistent with your ethics code policy, but let me step back and check that. But my question would be whether or not you are asking that public funds be directed absent a statute.
So I feel that Ms. Adekoya has been sitting in that chair as long as I have.
Longer, actually.
And I don't know that those who wrote the statute meant intentionally to exclude her. And I would like recommendations as to what this board's options are to make her whole, so to speak.
Separate from this policy.
Separate from this policy.
Okay.
Is that a motion?
Do we need a motion to request information?
No,
if it is,
it just
then
makes
yes,
it
it's
official.
A motion. It's a motion.
Second? All in favor, please say aye. Thank you. So that motion to receive a recommendation carries.
Don't believe Ms. Adekoya could vote on that. I don't. Okay.
One
but
abstention.
It would still pass.
One abstention from Ms. Adekoya. Back to policy 8250.
Yes, ma'am.
We actually had, did we have a motion and a second?
I don't remember.
No. You discussed it. If you discuss it, it's considered a second.
So moved to forward this to the, what are we moving? Forwarding it to the full board?
Yes.
Yes.
All in favor of moving policy 8250 forward to the full board? Please raise your hand. Thank you. Any opposed? Any abstained? Motion carries. And we are moving right along. Thank you very much to policy 8315.
Yes, and I do think this might require a little bit more time, and I know that the committee is pressed for time this evening. You do have currently stakeholder groups who, as you know, participate in all of your board meetings. This policy 8315, which is before you because of policy 8130, it is scheduled to be before you. It's on the five-year cycle. What staff is recommending that there be a definition of stakeholder groups, and second, that the policy be changed to conform with editing conventions. However, again, given the importance of your stakeholder groups to your public meetings and to the way that the board does business, I'm not sure if you have sufficient time to discuss this policy this evening.
Are there questions or comments related to this?
I'd like to move that we push this to the next meeting because I have significant discussion on this one.
Is there a second? All in favor of holding this over to the next meeting, please raise your hand. Any opposed? Okay, this policy is going to be held over to the next meeting. And that leaves us.
Policy 8330 behind yes. tab 10. So this policy is being recommended for change because of, again, the statute that was just provided to you, the Education Transparency Act. You have a minutes policy. The way I read the statute, the descriptions that are required by the Education Transparency Act are not minutes. They are descriptions and summaries of the actions that you've taken in your public board meetings. Nonetheless, what staff have done, what we've done is to incorporate what is in the statute in your minutes policy.
Are there any questions or comments on the revised policy 8330? Is there a motion to move this forward as revised to the full board? Is there a second? All in favor, please raise your hand. Any opposed? Motion carries. Thank you.
And then finally, tab 11 is related to social media research that Ms. Causey asked. You do not have anything behind your tab, but you do have something else to... Something else to for your reading pleasure and enjoyment based on Ms. Causey's request at a board meeting concerning social media policies that is provided for you.
For the next snow day, and board members can, as they're reviewing this, reflect on it for our board handbook and or for possibly asking staff to make a policy recommendation. Yes, Ms. Rowe.
For the sake of prioritizing reading materials, which one should we read first, this social media policy research or the gigantic discipline policy book? What's our time frame on having these finished?
Well, the discipline policy policies we're going to take up again at the next meeting, as we already asked staff to make recommendations and bring them out to us so that we could move them forward to get them in compliance with the law, because we are... It's been 3 years since they've been revised, and there's been law changes. So that is a high priority.
So the discipline first, got it.
Yes. Okay. So I'm moving on?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So our next PRC meeting coincides with the march for our schools in Annapolis. Due to this conflict, and if it pleases the committee, I am suggesting that we meet earlier in the day on March 11th. Would everyone provide me with your availability between 11 to 1 on March 11th by raising your hand if you will be available for the policy review committee? So we have four members and one checking. And we appreciate staff looking through the schedules and the room availability to make that as a possibility for us. It's a very important event, as folks from all over the state that are supporting education and increased education funding are going to be headed to Annapolis to make our presence known. So Ms. Pester is also available? That's great. Thank you very much. So as the chair of the committee, I will set the meeting for March 11th at 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. And we appreciate staff and board members being flexible with that. The floor is now open to members of the committee to discuss any issues this is under the item number 4 committee for the general good and welfare. I must emphasize it's not the time to conduct business, as there has not been notice provided as required by the Open Meetings Act for something specific on the agenda, but you could make a recommendation of an issue that's of importance to you. Okay, hearing nothing. Is there any further business, Ms. Howie?
No, ma'am.
Okay, since there's no further business, the meeting is adjourned.